impressive in getting cameras into the kit, their 995 large bars. I just think it's just a conspiracy theory that you put out there, and maybe one day I'll stand corrected, but for now I'll feel quite credible.
What he wanted to know was if he raided the
yes, you will. I haven't got that on approval from the Palmer, but I'm sure you've heard. I don't know whether it's down there or somewhere else in the US or spread around the country. Maybe some of them in the US meet in terms of their votes. There are many authorised comic sponsors and whatever else around. So I'm sure it's spread around rather than one location as well. So, have you got a few minutes left?
Yeah.
I'll run to Silver. Silver's cricket, by the way, if that's it. So just very, very quickly, different dynamic, looking at the global third again, and although I'm focusing on jewellery and investment, you can see the largest component is industrial applications, photovoltaics, electrical, whatever it may be. That's not very price sensitive in the short term. Again, we've got photography, which is long-term decline, that won't surprise you. Hedging is something similar to gold, so we've had a big old rundown on the hedge book, not much left of it, hence why we've got zero de-hedging for 2014 and 15. And so the jewelry and silverware, yes, it picked up in 2013, but not as dramatic, and there's a very good reason that we'll come to in a moment, whereas the physical investment went to the races. And that's basically because of one market that we'll come to. So, silver jewellery, just a couple of brief slides. The largest market for consuming silver jewellery by a long, long margin is the US. Yeah. It's not produced in the US, but that's where most of it is sold. And I've put the gold and silver on here, because although I've got silver and gold in separate parts of my presentation, the two are obviously entwined. There is a knock-on effect. There's a strong relationship between the two. Otherwise, one would often trade the gold-silver ratio. And again, this is US jewelry imports, again, value only. And the gold, I showed you earlier. The silver, again, one has to discount the silver price, which is included in here. Even without that, it's done quite nicely. And what we've seen is that especially branded, come back to the branded thing, and private label have done fantastically well. And that's very important. Again, when we think about what is the outlook for each market, and therefore what price support can it provide, this is what it all comes about back down to. It's not what they're selling, it's what price support, what is the mechanism, what is it actually going to do to the dollar per ounce that's being traded. And what we've seen now is that this decline here, because the silver price has come off heavily. That's the only reason. What we've seen now, since last year, is that in the US, as gold jewelry sales have grown, silver has continued to rise as well. It hasn't really encroached massively on its territory. It's really easy. Gold has really grown from plated products, for example, has lost market share to carat gold. Whereas sterling silver and carat gold were both doing okay. So that's positive for both markets. And why is it important? Well, because as I said, the US is the largest consumer, it's therefore the largest importer, and therefore it's taking large quantities from India. And I just put on here Thailand and China, just to give you a sense. And then these are total Thai and total Chinese, not what's just going into the US. But the US accounts for about a third by value of the Thai shipments and about half of Chinese shipments. So it's absolutely huge. And again, you can see this uptrend. So in terms of the impact on those fabricators and on their call on the market, it's quite significant. So that's my silver jewellery, the whirlwind of that finish. So silver investment. Now, you may remember the gold ETF, where in 2013 had a big old drop. Here, nothing of the sort. In fact, it's increased. And there is no inconsistency here. What's happening is that, whereas for gold, the majority, and I can't give you a half percentage, the majority is the high net worth professional. For silver, the majority is retail. and the retail in both gold and silver is much stickier. And that's why we've had this. So on the one hand, it's a positive, because we didn't have a huge liquidation because it's sticky. On the other hand, we've got a 20,000 ton overhang in the market. So make of that what you will, whether it gives you a reason to sell or think they're sticky and not going to liquidate.
What prompted the rise in silver with the factor sale?
This price here?
No. I mean, if you look at the investment ETF,
yeah.
The central reason since 2008. Yes. So what are the factors? Were they similar to what gold factors were?
Quite enough, because raw material silver either is a precious metal or as an industrial metal. Here, it's really taking on sort of its precious metals quality. So they were, you've got to bear in mind what gold was doing. Gold was moving up, so some retail investors would have been priced out of gold, and therefore they're buying silver. And they're also using that as a leverage play on gold as well. So they're not exactly being pushed out of the market completely. So that was an important factor. And as the fact that ETFs, both gold and silver, in a sense broadened the investor base. I didn't have to buy a physical product, I don't want to buy equities or that type of thing. And so I understand this because I'm treating it like a share, and therefore my broker understands it because he's recommending it to me. I don't know about ETFs, I'm trusting my broker. And if he understands it, then I'm now coming into this. And of course prices are rising generally, and so I'm getting yield of this, I get upside as well. So it's sort of a win-win from that point of view, and therefore drawing more investors into the market as well. And so, slightly different way of looking at it, I just sort of split out bars and coins. It doesn't matter so much for the Indian market, because it's overwhelmingly a bar market, but elsewhere it matters quite considerably. And you can see in 2012, that coins was larger. This, again, is because of one market and one market only. We'll come to that. So, first of all, the coin front, just to give you a sense briefly, whereas India is a bar market, the US is about 35 or 60-40 in favour of coins. And that's risen quite nicely. Do I say why? Yes, I do. And what we see is partly a mistrust of the government. It may sound strange, but there is this deep mistrust in certain areas, and so there is this sort of this bunker and baked beans mentality, if that makes sense. And part of that involves buying coins. If you think back to December 1999, before 2000, many people thought when we change over, the banking system would fail. And so we saw in the US huge buying of fractional gold coins, because I can take my 10,000 to a gasoline station and buy some bread. And this was huge buying. And then in 2000, when the world didn't end, it all got sold back. And that goes to show that, gold and silver, they retain this position. And when the crisis really hits, then people do return to it. But you need a big crisis, or the perception in that case of a crisis as well. And so we've had this mixed picture, rising quite nicely in the US, a bit of weakness, and then a bit odd here, but overall, it does seem to be picking up again. But for the bar market, and where the action's really at, it's all about one country. Only one country matters here. And no surprise where that is. So, we saw a huge increase, and again, it is partly gold related, because expectations were key to this, what the silver price was doing. But when the Indian government banned the sale or the import of small bars, well, that benefited the silver market and continues to benefit the silver market as well. So even though 2014 is down heavily, well, look what it was in 2012. That's not a bad number. Again, I think sometimes we've got to put into context the market, and the 2013 comparison, that's just unrealistic. Quite unrealistic. And so we are still expecting 2014, the numbers are not too shabby at all for the Indian market. And this is important from a price action point of view. 2013, the market